people in America fear their government, and the government is being run by too many powerful agencies like the IRS and others, I think it's time the people take the country back through their representative government.
Hey, Mr. Politician, living on that hill, living in that lap of luxury on We the People's Bill. Don't have a clue how the other half lives, and that is a shame. It's time to stop the tyranny. You keep pushing through your bills, calling for a revolution. Calling for it now. It's time to save our Constitution while we still got the guns in our hands.
I'm Renee Kimball, and we have a very interesting show for you today. We're going to be talking to some folks from Home PDX, and this is a kind of a different concept about helping the homeless. So we're going to be talking about that a little bit later, but first, I'm going to get on my Sovereign's Soapbox. So we're going to have a little bit of a discussion. This is my opportunity to kind of talk about the things that I want to highlight. And today I'm going to be talking about healthcare costs and why some of them might be a little high. A friend of mine just told me that she's been let go from her job with a major medical facility here in Portland. And when I asked her, well, what are you going to do? She says, oh, well, I don't really have to worry about too much because the union has made it possible for me to still get paid full time for my job for 1 year after she'd been let go. So, and I asked her, well, do you have to go into work? And she said, well, they'll probably call me once a week, and I'll have to go in for a few hours. So when you consider the costs of health care, that's one of the things to look at. Mandatory situations like my friend is going through, where she's going to be paid for a year without actually doing any of the work, and that does contribute. So with that in mind, we're going to go to a short roll-in, and this one is called Two Women. This is about some of the healthcare situations that are going on in Canada. And it's a good idea to look ahead and help yourself decide whether maybe Katrina Care might not be such a good idea. So with that, we'll go to Two Women.
About 2 years ago, my bladder quit functioning. You just can't urinate. You're in pain.
If somebody needs it,
Janice Fraser of Ontario, Canada, needed to have a small device installed that would send mild electrical signals to her bladder to make it function. There was just one small problem.
I'm sorry, he says, I can only do 12 a year. I've got 30 on the waiting list right now. No, 32 on the waiting list. You'd be number 32.
12 a year, and she's 32. What are we talking about here?
You're looking close to 3 years.
Go away. She's got a 3-year list. I can't do anything for her.
I felt terrible.
She felt terrible. We both left there crying our eyes out.
While Janice stayed at home wearing a catheter, her mother, Mary Ann, went to bat for her, writing letters to patient relations and the surgeon, visiting the hospital, contacting the media, and pleading with authorities to move Janice up the list. She even tried to do something very un-Canadian.
And my mother offered, could we not pay to have it done ahead of time?
And we were told, definitely not. You're a Canadian citizen, you can't pay for your health care here.
And they said, you're in Canada? What? You can't pay, you're a Canadian citizen.
I wouldn't have cared what we had to do. I wanted her to have the operation, just have that neurostimulator put on.
I was getting infections after infections after infections. Very sick. I was getting fevers, 103, 104, pain almost 24 hours a day.
Mary Ann Fraser was becoming desperate. She enlisted the help of her representative in Parliament, Ted Arnott, who took a letter from her to the Minister of Health for Ontario, George Smitherman.
He's taken letters and he'd put them in his coat pocket and he'd take it down, make sure that he handed it directly to him
letters from me, and he paid no attention.
Health Minister George Smitherman is the ultimate health care gatekeeper for the 12.5 million citizens of Ontario. He and his people wouldn't meet with Marianne Fraser to discuss Janice's increasingly desperate health situation. However, they would meet with another citizen.
You know, I believe God wanted me to be a woman, but the angel got the directions wrong. So I'm just really an average person. I'm a student and I'm a woman, and my life is easier if you see me as female. So some medical procedures are helpful in accomplishing that goal. Some people might know it better as sex change surgery. We think nothing of so many procedures. Why should this be any different?
Susan Gapka is a male-to-female transsexual who is lobbying the government of Ontario to pay for sex change surgery. Health Minister Smitherman had promised to provide coverage for the surgery before taking office.
Our very first meeting was with him when he was in opposition. He called me helpfully aggressive in bringing the matter to his attention. George is an openly gay minister of health.
Meanwhile, Janice Fraser still waited. Unfortunately, too long. The constant infections caused by wearing a catheter caused Janice's health to deteriorate to the point that doctors had to remove her bladder in order to save her life.
Didn't have to happen at all. If I got the help, it wouldn't have happened. It didn't have to happen. Well, I get upset, start crying and getting grumpy and miserable. Yep.
Well, I mean, you know, I'm a feminist, sometimes a radical feminist.
She went through severe pain and agony.
I just want to imagine sometimes, like, if women ruled the world or ran the world. They said there wouldn't be a word called ruling. there wouldn't be rulers, I think, if women ran things.
The system failed her. Smitherman failed her.
Good old Georgie. I shouldn't say that on camera.
The health minister would not meet with me at any time.
Idiot. Asshole.
It feels, you feel terrible because you've been able to help your kids all of their lives. You've been able to, you know, you could do anything for your kids. And all of a sudden, this is one thing I just couldn't do. I couldn't help her.
Hi, welcome back to Freedom TV, and I'm here with two great people from an interesting organization called Home PDX. This is Ken Lloyd and Jessica Roye, and I want to thank you for being here on the program, because when I heard about what you did and how you interact with the homeless, I went, well, frankly, I went, these people are crazy. But I had to have you on the show to talk about what you do, because it is so unique and so unusual. Now, can you tell me a little bit about exactly how your organization works with the homeless and how very different it is from how other organizations work with the homeless?
Well, I think, Renee, typically most organizations deal with our friends that live outdoors as clients. We see them as friends. It seems like a small semantic difference, but it's a huge difference in the way we view our friends downtown.
Right.
And the result is that most of the people that show up in the park where we meet see us as, they tell us, you're the only ones that respect us. You're the only ones that listen to us in downtown Portland. I'm having to assume they're telling me the truth.
Right.
And so that's probably one of the major differences. We love our friends. We hang out with our friends. We do what we can for our friends, but mostly we love them face to face.
And right. So this is basically a different philosophy of dealing with people, is looking at them as people in your environment, people that are should be there, rather than people who should pass through my environment and then move on and become something different. You accept them for who they are and what they are, mm-hmm. and just deal with them on that basis. Mm-hmm. Jessica, how did you get involved in this?
I had originally worked several years ago for an organization that was a drop-in center for kids who, street kids, mostly traveler kids. And through that, through that opportunity, I was able to develop relationships and see a part of Portland that I had not been accustomed to, and really fall in love with that culture and see that need and want to figure out a way to find solutions and have people be treated as individuals and humans rather than problems. And I've known Ken for a while, and we shared that same desire and passion for equality, basically. So he started this while I had gone off to Texas for a while to do some after-school programs, and I came back, and then I came on board with him. And it started very small. Started handing out pastries and socks in Pioneer Square and getting to know people. And it grew to different, we're constantly changing the way that we're doing things because we're finding out what people like and what people need.
Right. Now, how old is this organization? How long have you been doing this?
Home PDX is 2.5 years old. We've been going downtown for about 7 years.
So the organization came after what you were actually doing.
Right.
So it kind of grew out of doing that. What prompted you to go downtown and start doing this, Ken? What made you feel like you wanted to start participating this way?
My wife and I founded a church along with another woman, Crystal Ward, in 1998 here in Portland. And mostly the people that we connected with were cast-offs from the church world. They were artists, musicians, and generally in one way or another had found themselves unwanted in a more traditional setting. Mm. And so that was kind of our original group of people, our original community. And but I noticed in downtown Portland there were huge numbers of people who didn't seem to have a place to go, who didn't seem to have anyone to care for them. And it took me 2 years to screw up my courage to go down there because the media reports indicate that they are violent and dangerous and thieves and so on like that. And we went, myself and Kim Nicholson, a mother of nine, went downtown. And we thought, well, if we die, we die. As it turns out, these are beautiful, funny, optimistic, intelligent people. There are violent people there, but violence is throughout our culture. So probably not much different than in the normal culture. It's just that because the people who live outdoors in Portland are so visible, if one of them is violent, we assume all of them are violent.
Right, and that's very true. Mm-hmm. And that's the disadvantage of looking at people in groups, of saying, oh, well, the homeless are. Well, that's like saying everybody who has brown hair is. We would consider that very patently ridiculous. But it's okay to make little boxes for other kinds of people and decide what the criteria for that little box is. Now, you don't call them homeless. What did you call them?
Our friends who live outdoors.
Our friends who live outdoors. And do most of them live literally outdoors? Or do they have places where they can go? And
there aren't a lot of... There aren't nearly enough services available for people who need shelter, especially in the winter. Like last winter, we had a pretty bad freeze, and there were quite a few people who didn't have access to shelter. There's a way that the government defines a homeless person and what homeless is, and it's a very clear definition. I don't necessarily know that our definition or how we view the people that we spend our time with fits into the governmental definition, but they are without permanent shelter or housing for the most part.
That's pretty much the line.
And that could be couch surfing involved in the like Dignity Village and the camp and long-term camping. We have people who are a part of our core team and volunteer with us, though, like people who live both inside and people who live outside, because our goal is to bridged, like come equally and have a relationship built on equality rather than giving a service and reaching down to someone. Like we all would like the world to be a better place and people to be treated better, and that it works in order to have that happen ever. It's going to be a lot easier, I think, if we reach across rather than reach down and go, well, here, I'm in my house, here you go.
Right.
if that makes sense.
No, and I can understand that. Now, one of the things that you do that's a little bit different is I understand that you actually invite them into your home.
Yes.
Now, how has that worked out? Why did you, first of all, why did you decide to do that? Because I'll be very honest with you, that's pretty risky kind of territory for most people to think about. It's like, yeah, okay, fine. What made you decide that this was a good idea, that you'd try this?
Well, let me tell you a story. We had a party at our house, and probably, I'm guessing, 30 or 40 of our friends showed up, some who lived indoors, but probably 20 that lived outdoors. Foolishly, I left $60 on the counter in the kitchen. Now, in order to get to the bathroom, which everybody needs during a party, every single person in the building had to walk past that $60. When I left, I discovered the $60. Oh, no, you know, it was my thought. But then that told me who our friends are. We've never lost so much as a penny in our house. We've never had any damage to our house. We've never had any complaints from the neighbors. Our friends respect us as we respect them. And so we've had no problems with our friends. And I think if you call someone friend, at some point or other, they'll end up in your house.
Right. And so your philosophy is that you treat people like friends, and you invite your friends over to your house. So therefore, if you treat these people like friends, then they're going to respond with that same kind of mentality. And so for the whole time that you've been doing this, that's been working pretty well?
Oh, it works perfectly.
And the people respond in like manner as being your friend.
Right.
Absolutely.
Right.
Absolutely.
Excellent.
And we're not, I wouldn't want to suggest to anyone to invite a stranger to come over and hang out. These are people who are a part of our community and we have a relationship with. We're
so
not
they're not
walking
people
down.
That you just met on the street, hey, come on over to my house and, you know, hang out.
Right, they're people that we meet through other people who we have a relationship with, or they're people who come and are a part of Home PDX, and we've developed relationships with them.
Right.
We're not inviting strangers.
Right.
I don't
suggest that. There is this connection between people that you feel okay with this person, and then that person feels okay with that person, so that it's not just a, you know, cold.
It works the same way as like my girlfriends and I when we go out or barbecues or what.
If you go out on a date, what are you going to do? Walk out on the street, hey, you look good, let's go out on a date. Nah.
Right.
You're not going to do that with inviting people into your home. Well, we do have a few pictures, and I would like to bring those up, and you guys can talk a little bit about what we're going to be seeing in these pictures, and this will give people a little bit of an idea about what you do. So here's a couple of people.
That's Mike. PDX Urban Outdoorsman is his blog, one of the funniest blogs in history.
He calls himself, what is it, the Rush Limbaugh of the Rush Limbaugh of Portland, or the out, like, it's pretty, he's the conservative traveling man.
He calls himself the Lars Larson.
Lars Larson. He likens himself to Lars Larson of the outdoors here. And he's a person who lives outside.
Yes.
Great. But he has access to a computer and he does a blog. That's interesting. That's very
interesting. And he's absolutely brilliant. He's just a brilliant man, a funny guy, kind and thoughtful, and just a fabulous person.
And then the woman over there on the right?
That's me.
That's you?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. I couldn't tell that. That's excellent. Okay, and our next picture is... Okay, we got a few people here. I think it's a dog down on the left.
That's Pumpkin Dog. A lot of our friends that travel have dogs. And then looks like we are in the top one. It looks like we're getting ready to play wiffle ball. And we play, there's quite a bit of wiffle ball that happens when we get together outside. And that's what a semi-typical, those two pictures are what a semi-typical day, Sunday afternoon looks like.
Of just getting together and having fun with friends,
although that's not entirely typical, because the woman in the lower right hand picture is Amanda Fritz, city council.
Oh, she's that picture?
Yeah, she's talking to Embu.
Oh, I couldn't tell
that would not be typical. No.
This is a cold day. Some of the days are cold, so we have to tuck ourselves underneath the bridge. And that's Jester up in the upper left-hand corner. And Vern and Jeff in the lower left-hand corner, Vern and Jeff are on our core team. And Jester is just a funny guy.
By the name.
And that's Pumpkin Dog again. She's probably the sweetest dog on earth. Mm-hmm. And she looks, her mouth is about 6 inches wide. And she's a pit bull.
And she just cuddles all the time.
And she's just a sweetheart. She's been in our home. Her and my cat get along.
Really?
Right.
And that's Ken with the long green jacket and the backpack. That's you, right?
Yep.
And that's what it looks like when we go and hand out socks and burritos during the week. That's the gear.
And this is a notice, a picture of a notice. So this is, they post this and then people can't sleep wherever this is posted?
Well,
is that the idea?
The theory is the state law says that that they have to provide written notice 24 hours in advance and then provide a social worker there to help people as they clear, they call it a sweep, as they remove people from underneath a bridge or a campground. Typically, the Portland police don't find it necessary to use the notices, but they did in this case, which we were happy
right.
about.
And what is the purpose of the sweeps? Why do they do the sweeps? I mean, they know people are going to be back, duh.
Right. The purpose is to get rid of the homeless. But what it tends to do is it puts a little Band-Aid. It's not a solution to the issue of lack of housing or resources. It puts a Band-Aid on something, but it just pushes people out farther to the suburbs or farther away from where they could access jobs.
Right.
So in the city of Portland, it's illegal to sleep outdoors, but if you don't have a house,
where are you
going to sleep?
Exactly. I thought this was kind of a cool little sign.
That's true. They call it white gold socks.
White gold.
Because if your feet are your only transportation and showers are few and far between, then clean socks are absolutely critical.
Right. Because if your feet get infected, mm-hmm. you're going to be in a world of worry.
Mm-hmm.
And that's somebody's house in a grocery cart.
So this is the grocery cart. Are they using it as a house, or is that their, that is their sum total of their worldly possessions?
That is their worldly possessions.
Right.
Most of our friends have backpacks, and they call them a house because that's everything they own is in that backpack.
In the backpack, so that's their house.
This is the aftermath of a huge meal. I can't eat another bite. It's music to our ears, and they're just laying around on the lawn. I think the one in the blue, light blue, might be me. I'm not sure.
I could Thanksgiving Day every day. Mm-hmm. And we love people face to face. I thought that was a good logo and a
good
slogan.
That's
excellent.
That's what
Thank
we
you.
Do. We do other things too, but
that's. And this is some of the chow line there. Sounds pretty good.
These are some of our servers. These were from the Bridge Church, I believe,
mm-hmm.
That day.
We have different churches and families who volunteer to provide a meal every Sunday.
Oh, I see. So you actually partner with some other people who come in. Mm-hmm. And then the last one down there, Anything Helps.
Anything Helps.
And that's a sign.
Mm-hmm.
Well, thank you very much for sharing those photographs with us. Mm-hmm. I think they give you kind of a good overview of some of the things that you're involved in and mm-hmm. some of the people that you deal with. And as you can see, they're not, you know, butt-stomping folks who are going to cause a lot of problems. They're just normal people
mm-hmm.
who happen to live outdoors.
Mm-hmm.
We're going to take a short break,
okay.
and then we're going to come back. And right now we're going to go to a film of someone who has been on the show in the past. And this was Judith Golden by nature and Golden by name, who now lives in Southeast Asia and does tours in Southeast Asia to help people tour and at the same time bring school supplies into the country and help build wells in small country villages. So this is Angkor, Earth Magic Tours. Thank you. Hi, welcome back to Freedom TV. That was Judith Golden in Angkor, and the music that you were listening to is actually a band composed, comprising people who are landmine victims, and this is the only way these people can make a living is to do their music. And we're here with Ken and Jessica from Home PDX, mm-hmm. and we're talking about our friends who live outdoors. Mm-hmm. There you go. And how you treat them a little bit differently. And I had a question for you. It's like you said socks are white gold. Mm-hmm. How do these people deal with foot problems, and how do you help them deal with it? I mean, this has got to be a little bit expensive here.
Well, we provide foot powder.
Right.
It's been suggested that we get a large canister of foot powder and pour it into plastic bags and give it to our friends. But we've really felt that when you give somebody a gift, you tell them who they are in your sight.
Right.
One of the things right. we do in downtown Portland is we do magic tricks. We make invisible things appear. and as we love our friends as equals, they begin to appear to their own eyes. Hmm. And as a result of that, they begin to think about their future and dream dreams again. It's a very long process.
Right.
We have a 5-year plan, a 10-year plan, and then a until I'm dead plan. for
okay.
our friends downtown.
Right.
So we give them little teeny canisters that fit in a backpack of foot powder. Now, the foot powder helps, but when the foot rot is out of control, then that's a visit to the emergency room. Very expensive because there are no clinics. If you're age 25 to probably 45 or 55 in downtown Portland, there are no clinic facilities for you. So then a visit to the emergency room is incredibly expensive, as opposed to costing taxpayers maybe $60 for a visit that could easily take care of most problems. We're probably looking at $1,000 or more.
Right. So that's, again, driving up healthcare costs because something that could be taken care of in a very limited situation. I'm here, here's, you know, we'll clean it out. Put some antiseptic in it, and you're
exactly.
home and hosed. Then it's going to be all of the medical expenses of doing an emergency room visit. What about some of the things with the homeless? I keep saying homeless. Sorry, but you know it's like ingrained as part of genetic coding here.
It's a term that everybody understands.
And to be honest with you, I can't say my friends who live outdoor because they're not my friends because I don't know them.
Right.
So I have to say homeless because that's who they are to me. So it's not a derogatory term. Mm-hmm. It just means that's who they are because they don't have a home. How do these people deal as far as relationships go with each other? I mean, if I'm thinking of, you know, you get a lot of these people together, there's going to be personality clashes. So you're bringing these people into your home. Is there some kind of unwritten rule that, you know, when you're here, you got to behave?
I don't think that there are any more personality clashes than there are with any other group of people. I have, of course, there is a number of people who live outside who suffer from mental health issues because there's a lack of mental health and rehab available for people who live inside and people who live outside. But all in all, I have yet to go to a party or get together with our community where there's been any kind of like ruffling of feathers or disagreement.
Right.
I mean, I see more of that with my dad's family.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
And when we get together outside, I can't think of a time, and maybe you can, when there was a problem. It's just like bringing any other group of people together for a baseball game or a picnic or the family reunion, except when it's the family reunion, I think ours is a little bit more calm.
Yeah, families can get a little out of hand.
Because we have so many people that hang out with us on Sundays that, like, as many as, like, 150.
Really? Many?
Oh, absolutely.
Whoa. I was thinking like 15, 20.
Oh, no.
Whoa. Sometimes well over 200.
Well over 200 people.
Towards the end of the month, as the food stamps run out, and we get larger crowds.
So just like any big group of people, you have like your young kids who are going to congregate over here, and they're going to play their guitars together.
Right.
You have the old dudes who are playing a card game.
Right.
I've learned how to play so many card games from these guys.
It's incredible.
And so many bad jokes.
And that was something I wanted to ask you. What are the demographics? What's the range of people that you see? Are they mainly in particular areas, or is it split up a different way?
Well, we concentrate entirely in downtown Portland, and probably, I'm guessing, from maybe four or five blocks north of Pioneer Square on south to the university. So we have a very small area that we concentrate in because we're very small.
Yeah.
I mean, we're one of the smallest nonprofits in downtown Portland. Our budget is probably less than $50,000 a year.
So that's very, very tiny.
Yeah, mm-hmm. That's teeny.
That's teensy.
I think bang for the buck, to get somebody a job usually requires an expenditure of maybe $150 to $200. That's clothes, cell phone. Without a cell phone, you can't get a job.
Right.
If you have a message phone from Day Watch or one of the other places downtown, employers never call back.
Really?
They never leave a message.
Really?
People don't want to hire homeless people.
Okay, yeah. And again, it's getting over the hump of being able to see that person.
Mm-hmm.
But again, you know, looking at it from the other side of the coin, once bitten, twice shy.
Right.
And if somebody does get bitten, well, then they're much less likely to do that for someone. Now, do you actually help people in that situation if they seriously want to get out of that particular lifestyle back into a more traditional lifestyle? Do you help them
do definitely. That? Oh, definitely. We would like to have the money to buy 5 cell phones a month instead of 1 or 2 a month.
And that's when you're talking about the $100 to $200 to help a person get back mm-hmm. into, that's things like clothes, and the cell phone. So these are like, what are they, disposable cell phones or something?
No, we get them Cricket phones.
And
the first month is free, and then they're on their own after that.
Oh, okay.
In one short period, I bought, I think, 8 cell phones.
Wow.
And within 2 weeks, there were 4 jobs.
Really?
Now, a jobs program, on the other hand, I don't know what they cost to get somebody a job. And a lot of our friends will sleep outdoors, use the cell phone for an alarm clock until they can get enough paychecks to get indoors, unless they have a bad rental history or something like
right.
that. Starting over again is very, very difficult.
Now, do you find that a lot of the people, what percentage of the people do you find that this is their preferred lifestyle as opposed to the people who are, okay, I can deal with this, but I really want to get back into something a little bit more traditional?
I don't know offhand anyone who is a part of our community that this is their preferred lifestyle. Like, they're in the summertime, it's fine to camp
right.
and hang out, but there are circumstances that perpetuate homelessness. Like, Oregon has the second highest unemployment rate in the country. Like, the number of people living without shelter and living without homes is continuing to grow, and women and children are increasing, the highest increasing population
right.
who are experiencing homelessness.
So in your experience, these people really want to transition back into having their own space and being responsible for themselves.
I think some would say, gee, I don't want to go indoors, I like this. But I think if there wasn't indoors, that viewpoint might change quickly.
Right.
If it was a safe place, if the rules were not so heavy, rules that none of us could live under. If in other words, if they were treated with respect, if they were treated provided with safe housing,
right.
I'm sure they'd be there.
Right. So it's there is this danger of living on the streets. It does have its, you know, moments of total freedom and lack of having to deal with all that other stuff, but there is always this constant danger situation that I can't imagine anybody wanting to live with that over a long period of time.
Right, and you are, when you are living outside and people who live inside walk past you and won't look at you or won't acknowledge your existence or you're talked about as a problem or a social stigma or you're marginalized or and your rights are ignored and you're targeted by the police. And like the money that we spend to ticket and fine people for menial crimes and put them in jail or send them to court, the money we spend on court costs could pay for transitional housing. It could get people into job placement.
And so it's basically band-aiding and incarceration rather than solving it.
Exactly.
Right. And we're going to be back in just one second. I want to explore that, and also I want to talk to you about ticketing. Excuse me, what? I beg your pardon. I want to talk about that when you get back. Mm-hmm. And we're going to take a short break right now. We're going to go to another video of some people who've been on the show before, Medical Teams International. And this is a very interesting video. It's called Real Life. So Medical Teams International with Real Life.
We're so sheltered in America, and we have no idea what's happening in the world. And as a teacher, it was so good for me to see my students becoming aware of what's happening.
Even just seeing that 25-foot wave and trying to imagine what a 90-foot wave would be like coming in and pulling people out. That really kind of solidified my understanding of what happened that day.
This is real life for millions of people in our world today. This is the world God loves. Step into Medical Teams International's Real Life exhibit and experience that world firsthand.
What really touched me was that half of the kids never get to their fifth birthday, because I have a younger sister that I love more than anything. Just tears were brought to my eyes as I saw the things I never knew were going on.
One of the things that hit me in the war-torn areas is that they're just people like us, recognizing that it could be me.
But walking through this exhibit, I'm seeing both desperation and hope. And I think the Medical Teams International is really bringing up that hope.
It gave me hope to know that every week there are volunteer teams going out all over the world to help the people that we have met here in this exhibit.
When before it seemed so overwhelming, I didn't see what role I really could play. Coming to the end of this exhibit, I guess, and seeing how even a few dollars can make such an impact.
I can make a difference.
No, I can make a difference.
I can make a big difference.
I'm gonna tell everyone about this. I'm gonna make sure something's done. I'm gonna get involved and get my friends involved.
It's important for students to see this exhibit because we are the next generation. We are the ones who are gonna make a difference.
I just would encourage you to come and see this for yourself.
It could change the course of a kid's life to know that they can make a difference, whether it's now or at some time in the future, to have a vision for what they could be in the next years of their lives.
It's a real eye-opener. It'll change your life forever.
Hi, welcome back to Freedom TV. And we're talking about our friends who live outdoors, mm-hmm. or as I call them, the homeless. Mm-hmm. Now, you mentioned something, and I went, huh? Ticketing the homeless? Oh, come on. Yeah, that's going to be the most ridiculous thing I've ever heard of. Well, I mean, look, they're homeless. It's not like they have money. How can you ticket somebody?
Yeah, I can't remember what the cost of the... Well, we'll see what happens now. But up until a few weeks ago, there was the sit lie ordinance that was downtown Portland, which meant that you couldn't sit or lie down during certain hours of the day for longer than 20 minutes.
I'm sorry, I'm just having trouble here.
And until about 2 or 3 weeks ago, it was ruled on by a judge that it was unconstitutional.
Duh.
But this is the third time that it had been written. This is the third time that the city council had tried to.
Yeah, think it might be a little unconstitutional.
Right.
What do
right.
you think?
So with that, what it did was it gave the Portland police an opportunity to possibly, if they chose to, profile. Because if I sat down on the sidewalk for 20 minutes, I probably wouldn't get ticketed.
Probably not.
But if somebody who looked as if they lived outside was sitting on a sidewalk for 20 minutes, they would probably get ticketed. And the excuse is, like, well, they're drinking, or they're possibly using drugs or alcohol, or they're harassing people. And in my opinion, well, then you respond directly to that problem.
Like, right.
You arrest somebody for doing drugs in public.
Mm-hmm. Right. But exactly.
But this was what they wanted to
but
do
they
instead.
Might possibly do it, so therefore we have to ticket them.
Exactly.
Preemptive strike.
So it was like between $200 and $300.
Oh, you're kidding.
No.
No. I'm sorry. You're going to ticket a homeless guy for $200. What, yeah. Are they nuts?
And are they going to have yeah. the money to pay?
Oh, right. That's going to happen.
But think about this. If you give enough tickets and a person owes a few thousand dollars, they're likely to move to another city.
Well, that's assuming they can get there.
Well,
which,
they can hop. They can hop a freight. They can hitchhike.
Yeah, that's true.
The younger ones.
The younger ones.
Now, the older ones typically are not able to do that, or are not willing to do that any longer. But that is one of the issues that has come up, is the way the police treat our friends downtown. Now, not all police are like that. On the sit lie ordinance, I think there were two officers that gave most of the tickets in downtown Portland.
Mm. Right.
And 80% of those ticketed lived outdoors, had no address. So it was pretty clear that there were, they had something in mind when they ticketed people.
Right.
I sat with a lawyer one day, and his dog was tied to a tree, blocking the sidewalk, and a police officer walked around the tree into the street to get past.
It was a lawyer.
and maybe the officer knew that.
Yeah. I think we have a phone call. Do you have a question for a guest?
Hello?
Yes. Do you have a question for them?
Yes. I'm wondering, like, what items we could, like, give to people that live outdoors. You know, like, you mentioned socks, you know, like something we could carry in our backpack if we happen to, you know, see someone. You know, that could use these items. What kind of items would those be? Thanks.
Thank you. Excellent question.
Excellent question. White crew socks
white
are the
crew
most
socks.
Common. Razors, shave cream. Shave cream, everything needs to be travel size.
Everything's
because
travel size.
Because if your house is on your back, then everything needs to fit in your house.
Right.
A shelf is a transforming object. I can put a large shave cream on my shelf, but my friend can only take a small one. Deodorant, foot powder.
Granola bars, protein bars.
Yes.
Those
anything
are easy
like
to carry
that?
Around.
Yeah, mm-hmm. Easy and they don't go bad.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Excellent. Excellent question.
Yeah.
So those are things that you can actually pass out to people. Because for me, I do not give money to people outdoors because I made a terrible mistake one time and gave a fellow named Indian Billy, who was an alcoholic, 50 cents, and the next day he was found dead from cirrhosis of the liver.
Okay.
I don't give money to people from outdoors because I don't want my 50 cents contributing to the death of another human being. So this is a good idea.
I can give
something to somebody, mm-hmm. and I know they're not going to either blow it up their nose, stick it in their arm, or trade it off or something, mm-hmm. they can blow up their nose or stick in their arm. Mm-hmm.
On the other hand, often when a person is spanging, that's spare changing, or panhandling, they could be spanging for laundry, food,
right.
any number of things. So
right.
we really don't know. But everybody has to make their own decision
yeah, exactly.
In this matter as to whether you give money or not.
Right. And I think we have another. Do you have a question for our guests?
Yes, I'm not all that familiar with Dignity Village, but I was wondering how, what you think about that as a model. I know that I thought that some of the people have a residence that way where they can work out of it. And they're kind of outdoors, but they have shelter. So I'll let you comment on that. Thank you.
Okay, Dignity Village. Do you have any kind of feeling about Dignity Village or what they're doing or how that's working?
We are good friends with Ibrahim, who is the co-founder of Dignity Village. He's a wonderful, wonderful man. And he is working, advocating to have another type of Dignity Village closer into town.
Mm-hmm.
And I haven't gone to Dignity Village in a long time, but I know that it provides permanent shelter for people and gives people an opportunity to stay somewhere and go to work. Most of the people who are living at Dignity Village are working. The problem with Dignity Village is it's so far away from the city that in order to get to a job that is in the Portland metropolitan area, you have to pay for transportation from your place of employment all the way to the airport, back and forth every single day.
Right, so and that's where Dignity Village is.
Yeah.
It's out by the
mm-hmm.
airport.
It is out
yeah,
by
I
the
wasn't
airport.
I wasn't clear exactly where that mm-hmm. was. So that's a long haul,
mm-hmm.
and it's going to take you a lot of time to do it too.
And I was in Nicholsville in Seattle, which is a new Dignity Village essentially. And what I saw was a peaceful place where the rules made sense to the residents. And I think sometimes we don't realize that a middle-class lifestyle is an infinitely complex series of maneuvers mm. just to stay housed
yeah.
and pay the bills and so on like that.
Right.
If you're not familiar with those rules, if you're not familiar with the regulations that the city and state have,
right.
and so on like that, then it is very bewildering. But I found it to be a very peaceful place, lots of laughter. I felt included when I was there, just a very comfortable place.
Right. Now, do the people that you invite into your house, do you expect them to have certain responsibilities, like they're supposed to help you out with the dishes or do
this other
stuff?
I don't think we ever have to ask anybody to do mm-hmm. anything. It's just... It's the same way that any other, like they don't live with us.
Right, no.
So it's, you have a party and people end up in the kitchen doing the dishes and people
right.
end up outside and people spill things and clean them up. It's no different than
right.
any other type
so
of.
So they do take on this role of personal responsibility
mm-hmm. Absolutely.
For what's going
yeah,
on.
Yeah, every week we have big serving trays and we ask 10 people to volunteer to serve all of the other people that are eating. So
cool.
we probably had 150 people today. So those 10 people fed all of the other people before they ate. I bring a little truck down with all of our stuff. I never unload it myself. My friends unload the truck.
Right.
My friends load the truck back up at the end
right.
of the day.
And so you do and do you do this once a week?
We do this once a week.
Once a week. And so it's like basically a big party where everybody
comes
in. It's
a big party. It's a picnic.
And a picnic.
And then throughout the week, we're walking around downtown. You could see us with an IKEA bag full of stuff and handing out basic resources and just hanging out with the people that we know and meeting new people.
Right. And we have, just less than a minute here. I just want to ask you, where do you do the picnic? Where exactly is it located?
We do it under a bridge in Portland. We'd rather not say more. If somebody's interested in visiting us, then I'd like to have coffee with them first. Or Jessica would
enough.
Have coffee with them
yeah,
first.
Yeah, because it is a community. It really is a mm-hmm. community and a group of friends.
Right.
It's not just, come on down, whoever, whatever, which mm-hmm. is what you wouldn't want to be doing in your own home.
Right.
So mm-hmm. I want to thank you so much for coming mm-hmm. on the show
thank
and
you.
Describing what you're doing and telling people about some of the work you're doing. And again, all of this without accepting government funding, which is, to me, the most empowering thing about what mm-hmm. people are doing, is because you're solving the problem without relying on somebody else to give you the money to do it. You're actually taking the initiative to do it. So thank mm-hmm. you so much for what you're doing here in the community.
Thank you for having us.
Thank
it was great.
You. And thank you for joining us here on Freedom TV. We will see you next week. And my little brain has forgotten who's going to be on next week, but I'm sure it's going to be a very, very encouraging show. So join us. And until then, please, it's your voice. Keep using it. Bye.
I cried for my country, for the pain that it's been through. She's been made to suffer for the profit of a few. Storm clouds are out forming. Winds of change now touch our shores. I hear forefathers are crying as the dream's been cruised.
America, America, I show my love for thee with strength and loyalty. America, America, I show my love for thee.